and welcome to the Financial Wake Up Show. Each week, we explore and take a deep dive into awakening the financial abundance we all have inside of us. We educate and create awareness by focusing on fundamental principles of money, talking to business and community leaders about successful habits, while learning from each other how to build, protect, and create legacies. And now, here's your host, Daniel Choi.
And good morning to you all. It is a new day, and with each day comes a new beginning, a new chance to do something great, learn something new, and enjoy everything this great life has to offer. If you have not already done so, go to iTunes, go to Google Play, subscribe to the podcast. You can download all of our shows. You can also subscribe to the show on YouTube. You can find all of this under the Financial Wake Up Show with Daniel Choi. I am broadcasting live again on KCAA 1050 AM and 106.5 FM. I combine integrity with intelligence to wake you up to things you want to be doing financially. Check out our website, financialwakeupshow.com, or visit us on Facebook and Twitter. That is at TFWUS. If you have any doubt, just reach out. And on every show, we talk about three things: growing and protecting your wealth. Number two is exit planning, which is selling or transferring your business if you're a business owner, or retirement if you're an employee. And estate planning, which is creating a legacy while fully enjoying your money while you're alive. Back last year on an episode, I talked about how the financial industry today is similar to the medical field was at the turn of the 19th century. So let's go back in time to the early 1800s. Where you would see quack doctors who were traveling around in horse and carriages selling tonics across the United States, curing your health concerns. And these tonics you would drink, and there were claims that you would feel better. There was very little regulation. You know, they didn't have the regulations the FDA requires for drugs to be created today. It was like the Wild West in terms of medical standards. And if you go back to that time, people did their own medicine. They did their own diagnosis, their own treatments. They did their own dentistry, believe it or not. When their tooth hurt, they just pulled it out themselves. And, you know, did people heal from doing their own medicine and their own dentistry? Sure. I mean, people survived. But by 1876, 62 medical schools had been established. And all the medical schools required degrees by the year 1930. So until these regulations were put into play, these quack doctors would just sell and sell and sell their tonics, their potions, their cure-alls to people who just wanted better health. And if you look at your financial situation, can we survive right now from a financial aspect without getting the right help? Sure, we are survivors. It's not like it's required you work with professionals around you. But is that what we want? Just to simply survive? And I would say, why would you want that? Why would you just want to survive financially? We work very hard to earn money, whether you run a business or you're an employee. You save it, and then you turn around and pay the IRS more than you needed to. Or you had an emergency or an expected event that really takes a chunk out of all your hard-earned savings over time and all that investment growth. And maybe that could have been avoided. Or maybe the economy changes or the laws change and that dictates our financial success. Why? I don't think that's an ideal place to be, because a little bit of proactive planning, a little more information, and associating with the right people can either mitigate or even eliminate some of these negative effects on your financial situation. And I've said it before, I'll say it again. If having money and money alone was the answer to all this, then why would you see over 70% of lottery winners going bankrupt? Why would you read about athletes and entertainers who are out of money and have to work again after making millions of dollars during their prime? Why would you hear these stories if money alone was the answer? Because it's not the answer. There are tax, there are legal, there are life events that happen to us that derail us. Divorce, a recession in the economy that ruins your business, overspending, a medical emergency, an event, a bill you didn't expect to pay because of an accident, These are the things that destroy your wealth, your hard-earned wealth. It's not just about growing your money. It's about protecting it and having informed decisions that are advised to you instead of you going with emotions or gut feelings. And so this week's Wake Up Now segment is, who should I have on my dream team? In other words, who should I be associating with to get the most out of my hard-earned money? And to answer this, I'm going to give you today a list of people you should have in your life that can advise you. And these people make up your dream team, a group of people that gives you the information you need to make proactive decisions. You know, I always say this, Warren Buffett has a team of three floors filled of accountants and lawyers that advise him. And you should have a team of professionals ready to assist you. And who are they? Now, the first role I'm going to cover is, I believe, the most important. I'm going to call this person your quarterback. And for you music lovers, I'll call him your conductor. It doesn't really matter. Either way, you need one person that has enough of a deep knowledge base to advise you, and advise you not based on the media, not based on Google, not based on sound, but really understanding sound fundamental knowledge, comprehensive understanding of the laws, experience dealing with financial success and successful people, and the ability to use logic and math over emotions and predictions. Okay, so to illustrate this, let me give you a couple of stories. Let's start with a conductor, okay? Have you ever gone to a concert and there's an orchestra, and before the show starts, they're all tuning their instruments, okay? It sounds like a musical mess. There's no music. It's every individual performer tuning their instrument. All of a sudden, the conductor comes out. They tap their little baton thingy or whatever it's called. And all of a sudden, you have a symphony of music. Everyone is in concert with each other. It's amazing, the music that gets produced by so many different musicians. And let's go back to the quarterback or football team. You know, they play once a week, usually on Sundays. College, they play on Saturdays. But each day of the week, there are small meetings going on. The running backs meet, the defensive backs meet, the linemen meet. They all have these individual meetings. Then a few days before the game, the entire offense gets together, the entire defense gets together to come up with a plan. And then right before the game, the whole team meets and the coach coordinates so that 51 men play as one unit. Now, what if that meeting never happened? Okay, that would be like having a bunch of advisors being their own musicians or being their own football players going in every which direction. You'd have chaos. Okay, so you need to have some person that is central and running kind of like a CFO does to a company. You need to have that person in your life. So of the people that I list next, any of these can be your quarterback or your conductor. It should be someone you trust, someone who has your best interests, has knowledge that goes 20 feet deep and across all oceans. And I don't recommend you use your buddy who reads a money magazine once every 2 months, or your parents who say, well, back in my day, this is what I did, or anyone that uses conventional or follow the herd rules of thumb. Because, for example, if everyone says take an aspirin to cure your headache, that might work for most, but I happen to be allergic to aspirin, ibuprofen, and Advil, so I can only take Tylenol. If I followed the herd and took ibuprofen, I'd have trouble breathing. That would not be a good thing. And the same thing can happen to your financial situation. So with those guidelines, here are the people that you need on your team. Number one, an investment advisor. And I'm leading with this because I know this best. It's what I do. You need to have someone who can get you into banking, investment, bond, equity, real estate, and alternative investments. You've got to have somebody who's licensed to do that, to transact these for you at some point. And even when, you know, people and firms out there will advertise that you can do it yourself, keep in mind, even when you do it yourself, you're still paying fees to firms because they have the ability to broker these investments to you. You've got to use someone. The question is, what kind of value are you getting for the fees that you pay? Okay, so it's really important to have that first person on the team. Second, a CPA. And when I say CPA, hopefully it's not one that just files your taxes that you see just once a year right before April 15th. It's somebody who's proactive, looking for creative solutions to your tax return, to pushing every exercisable right and deduction you have. You know, one of the objections that I have for every client is that we pay our fair share of taxes, but that you seek every exemption, every deferral, every right you have as a taxpayer to mitigate the effects of unnecessary and excessive taxation. I think we should go for that. And if you only see your CPA once a year, I would start to examine that relationship, because you should have at least a year-end meeting prior to December 31st, for sure, because by the time you file your taxes, it's usually too late for you to make any moves to mitigate the effect of taxes at that point. And too many clients I see just see their person one time, give them a shoebox full of stuff, of documents, and then complain that they're paying too much in taxes. Okay, so that's a second, a CPA that's proactive. Number three, an estate planning attorney. Gotta have, if you own property, you have to have an estate planning attorney. And it's someone that has, again, creativity. Somebody who's not using templates or generic boilerplate trusts and wills, but an attorney that seeks to understand your situation, okay? It also is probably helpful that they have advanced planning strategies under their belt, okay? I'll list a few of those. ILETs, GRATs, CRTs, IDGTs. You don't need to understand what these initials mean, but your attorney sure better know, because a lot of these can mitigate the effect of taxation not only after you pass, but actually during your lifetime. There are many planning strategies that allow you to enjoy your wealth more, and your state attorney should be able to put those into effect for you. Number four, and by the way, this is not in any particular order, okay? It's just a random list. Number four, a real estate broker, somebody who stays in touch with you, keeps you informed, sends you information about home prices and trends in real estate. It's so critical, okay? These real estate professionals, they fight for you. They negotiate for you. They should make your transaction as seamless as it possibly can. This is oftentimes a very large purchase, and you want somebody who's on your side. If it's somebody that you don't know very well and you just found a flyer or something like that, you know, I would really look into seeking and interviewing and meeting real estate professionals that'll meet your need, and a broker is the key there. Number five, a mortgage broker. This is someone who has access to loans from different sources. You don't want somebody just pulling from one or two banks. You need somebody who can shop for the best rates, who can understand the tax benefits of having the mortgage, what the interest is doing to your cash flow, as well as, again, I keep saying this word, but creative mortgage design, somebody who's thinking on your behalf. You don't want someone who just puts you in whatever loan possible so that you get funded and they get a commission. That's the worst type, okay? An insurance agent. That's number six. This is also something I do and I know a lot about. You need someone with a diverse inventory, someone not just representing a captive company where the only thing they can offer is just that company's product line. And the reason that's so important is that there are no dominant insurance companies out there. There's no one like who's killing it in every category. Every company has good products. Every company has bad products. You have to be aware of the choices you have for the best rates, the best features, and the least amount of restrictions. You should be aware of advanced planning techniques in the insurance world. For example, using the cash value of life insurances for estate tax, for income tax, for retirement distributions, to get more money into your pocket that you've earned. And if all you're hearing is, you know, hey, buy this insurance because you can afford it, you know, this is the easiest way to do it, you got to reevaluate who you're using, for sure. Number seven, property casualty professional. Really important. Car insurance, home insurance, umbrella insurance. Insurance for your jewelry, your collectibles, your other valuables. This is so critical because, again, these often not only have financial value, they have emotional value as well. So whether you use online for this or you use a live person, this one for sure, make sure whoever your quarterback is or whoever your conductor is making sure that the coverage you have is in alignment with what you need to protect. So many times I've seen people who just get car insurance because they have to, who sign up for any home insurance because the mortgage company requires it, okay? There's more to this. There's a scientific way to look at it. Your property casualty professional is really important. T- Title and escrow company or title and escrow professionals, also really key. Your realtor sometimes already has these connections. However, you have a choice here. And remember, these are huge transactions. You're buying a home. You're buying a rental property. You're selling your business. You're buying a business. These transactions are stressful enough, okay? You should work with title and escrow professionals that make these complex transactions simple for you. In addition, you don't want to have pitfalls that happen during the transaction. Now it gets extended. You have issues. A lot of times you're moving or you're waiting on cash from the sale of a business. You've got enough on your plate. You need a team of title and escrow companies or professionals on your side. Now, if you own a business, there's a few more you've got to consider. So all the ones I just listed definitely should know who your team is on the personal side. On the business side, you've got to have, number one, a business valuation expert. They're called certified valuation analysts, CVAs, okay? Business valuation is one of the biggest issues I've seen with business owners. They don't know the value of their business. And it gets even more sticky when you have partners. You need to get valuations done during the good times. Because if you try to get a valuation done when you're about to sell your business or transfer ownership or change ownership, or worst case scenario, you have a disagreement with other partners or shareholders and you're about to dissolve the company, and then you try to get a valuation done, it gets a lot messier, okay? Very critical. It's not explored enough today. So business valuation expert, that's number one. Number two, investment banker, or if you've got a smaller business, a business broker. You need to have what investment banking, and our guest, by the way, today is an investment banker, so you're going to learn a lot about that. But you need to have someone who's looking for investors, making a market for your business, so you're getting the most possible cash out you can. And a lot of times I see business owners just take the first offer. Oh, you want to buy my business? Great. How much do you want to pay? And it's a handshake deal. I've talked about this on past episodes. Investment banking or business brokering, extremely important to find qualified persons that not only have financial means, but are the types of people you want to be transferring your business to, or else why are we working so hard for that business? Number three, got to have a great corporate or business attorney. This is so critical. Incorporations, formation documents, contracts that you're signing with your clients, with your customers, legal protection for the services. You've got to limit liability. Whether you're running a children's bounce house place where they have birthday parties, or somebody who's giving some type of service, you have to protect yourself against potential lawsuits, additional liability you're taking on. Not to mention there are tax consequences for how you are set up as a business. You've got to have a great corporate or business attorney on your team. Number four, a specialized tax either attorney or what I call a forensic CPA. These are masters of tax. And what they do is they help you avoid audits, get through audits, and make the most of your tax situation. They're typically not normal CPA firms that just file your returns. They are working traditionally, I've seen, in certain niche markets. And these firms also often have bookkeeping and accounting services to make sure your company is legally compliant with all the document filings and record keeping that's required by the IRS as well. So this is different, generally speaking, than your normal CPA, although some CPAs offer this as well. But you got to have somebody on your team that understands the ins and outs of the IRS and making sure your business return is much more complex than an individual one, generally speaking. Number five, a business insurance broker. This is different than personal insurance stuff. Workman's compensation, general liability, those are the basics. I mean, they're required by law. But you've got to explore other business insurances. I don't know how many businesses I've seen, they're working so hard and they're completely exposed to other types of risk. Things like business overhead coverage, excess liability coverage, so that your personal belongings and property is not at risk. Special types of insurance that may apply to your business because you have a risk for whoever's using your services. These are available through a business insurance broker that specializes in these types of things. Many times the insurances may be one-offs, so it's not like something you can just buy off the internet. You've got to explore this. Number six, and the last one, a health insurance broker. So important with changing healthcare regulations. You want to make sure they're up to date. You want to make sure that they know the latest, that they are setting up programs to retain your employees. Benefits is a big part of employee retention. You want to take care of them. A medical condition for an employee is a big stressor. And anytime employees are stressed out, they are less productive, particularly if they're stressed about something to do with money. That's why a lot of times I'll go into companies and do educational events to reduce the stress on the money side. Also make sure that your health plan is in alignment with your business cash flow and what you want to offer. And your health insurance broker is the key person there. So going back to the quarterback makes sure all these professionals are moving in the same direction for you. I can't tell you how many times I've seen an insurance agent who does something that doesn't flow with the investment portfolio, that doesn't flow with the mortgage that they have because they overbought this house and their real estate broker never talked to them about that. Their retirement is now in jeopardy. Not to mention they've got exposure to all of this kinds of risk through bad legal documents, wrong insurances, poorly written trusts. They're contested. You mix in some bad luck. And that's, folks, how you get financial collapse or significant loss of wealth, at least. You got family members arguing with you, usually over parents' estates. Everyone's highly charged emotionally. All of this can be offset or avoided altogether if you are proactive and plan correctly. So if you have any questions or need to get connected, call me, talk to me, reach out to me. Our Be Aware or Beware tip of the week is be aware of who is on your team. Is it a dream team? Who is your three floors of accountants and lawyers that Warren Buffett has? I mean, you're not going to have three floors, but who's playing these roles for you? Who's the quarterback or the conductor for you? Is your team in symphony together, or are everyone just playing their individual parts and roles and you've got a mishmash of financial stuff going on? Because beware that by not associating with the right people, your business, your hard-earned money could go to waste. Life happens. We know that. Good things and bad things. Money alone does not solve everything. You need to have contingencies and protections to make sure. If you have any doubt, just reach out. Daniel@financialwakeupshow.com. Email. Please, I urge you. This is important stuff. Okay, we're going to take a quick break. When we get back from our sponsors, I'm going to welcome our first guest to the show. As a reminder, you can call, email any questions on topics you have. You're listening to the Financial Wake Up Show with Daniel Choi, KCA 1050 AM and 106.5 FM. And welcome back from that quick commercial break from our sponsors. As I mentioned before the break, I have the privilege of bringing on a very special guest today. His name is Brian Ballow, Managing Director at Corporate Finance Associates. He's going to talk about one of the subjects I mentioned earlier in the show, which is investment banking. His skills include helping the owners of lower middle market companies extract the maximum wealth out of their businesses, both in majority buyout and minority recapitalization transactions. He also works on the buy side, not just on the sell side. On the buy side, he assists large corporations and private equity funds identify and acquire other platform and add-on businesses. He's got 18 years in this investment banking business, which is a tremendous amount of experience. He's been involved in transactions totaling an excess of $250 million, primarily in the aviation, technology, food and beverage, and manufacturing industries. His industry knowledge, quality relationships built through active participation in the industry have led him to success and differentiate him from other investment bankers. Currently, Brian focuses on providing investment banking solutions in the following areas. Number one, selling businesses, performing acquisition services for corporate buyers and private equity funds, and delivering innovative financial solutions and financing solutions. I talked earlier about the importance of creativity with the team members you have, and he certainly brings that to the table. A total of 28 years of corporate and real estate attorney experience that brings all of that to the table for you. The website to view his firm is cfaw.com. Brian, good morning. Welcome to the Financial Wake Up Show. How are you today?
Thank you for having me on the show, Daniel. I really appreciate it.
I am excited as well, because I think the topics that we're going to talk about are really important for our listeners, particularly those business owners who I know are avid subscribers and listeners to the show. Investment banking, it's a word that people throw around in conversation. A lot of people talk about it, but many don't even know exactly what it is. So let's start there. For our listeners, what exactly is investment banking?
That's a good opening question, Daniel. So let me answer a few different ways. First, an investment bank is a licensed financial intermediary, licensed as a broker-dealer by the Financial Industry Regulatory Authority, also known as FINRA. There's almost 4,000 licensed brokers in the United States employing over 600,000 licensed security brokers or registered reps, representatives, as we're known. The services that an investment bank provides involve handling financial transactions, such as underwriting the issuance of securities, acting as an intermediary between the company that's selling the securities and the investing public, facilitating mergers and acquisitions, that's the sale of business, what the main thing we'll be talking about here today, and providing financial advisory services. So in terms of the market out there, you've got different types of investment banks. You've got your big major Wall Street bulge bracket firms like Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, Morgan Stanley. These are the firms that are on the front page of the Wall Street Journal. And you've got your other middle market investment banking firms, and that would include Corporate Finance Associates. There's other good firms here on the West Coast, our competitors. And you need to distinguish that from two other categories, which I'll call licensed business brokers that are handling the purchase and sales of smaller businesses, such as businesses like in a strip center or with annual revenues less than $5 million. And then also unlicensed finders make introductions of other people's to a transaction, but they're not licensed and they should not be receiving percentage-based compensation, which is what it, the whole purpose of licensing is about and regulates.
Right. I talked about a couple of those categories early in the show, so I'm glad you're able to fortify those points. You know, we talk a lot about exit planning on the show, and finding a qualified buyer for a business is a complex, sometimes lengthy process. It's not one of these deals that you can just turn around and in a couple months you got something. Sometimes it takes several years. So what's a typical process that you walk a potential buyer or seller through on the transaction of a business?
Yeah, well, process is the right word, and it's definitely a process. And from a big picture standpoint, that first breaks down into a lot of pre-planning and positioning the business for sale. And that can take a couple years. And then secondly involves the execution of taking the business to market. At CFA, we've branded what a business exit process we call Next Step, the systematic team-driven program that guides business owners through the process of extracting both themselves and their wealth from the business. Really, it's five steps. First, you're going to start with a business valuation and marketability report.
Yep.
Look at what other businesses are selling for. You're also looking at how well, you know, is the company ready to go to market? I can talk a little bit more about how to improve that. Next, really, you know, developing the wealth plan, and that's what your firm and yourself are very good at, and looking at, you know, what's the business owner's personal goals for what he wants to do after the business and what he's going to do with his money.
Mm-hmm.
Then you develop, thirdly, kind of a business exit strategy plan. What are we going to do to get ready for that sale process? Some of that, fourthly, would involve positioning. And I'll talk about some ways to talk about that next. And then finally, really, you get into it. All this preparation has happened before. And then now, hey, let's go to market. Let's put together a confidential information memorandum, blind executive summaries that go out initially. The sale of business process is different than putting your house up for sale.
Right.
Or other types of things.
Right.
It's not, you know, posted in the newspaper, and it's a confidential process.
I appreciate that simplicity there, and the process shows you've got a lot of transactions under your belt. It shows that there's a pattern of success. One of those patterns I see is creating a business that makes it attractive to investors. And I've seen so many business owners who don't think of their business this way because they're not really thinking about exit, although they talk a lot about it. What are the steps that a business owner should take to maximize the proceeds from the sale of their business?
Well, the first thing is get your team together. And it really is a team approach to a sale of business. You need, the key people are your wealth advantage, your wealth advisor, your investment banker, tax attorney, or an accountant. Those are kind of the important people up front. And then there'll be a transactional attorney at the end that's going to document everything. You know, I think that the wealth advisor is very important, and the tax advisors, because there's too much focus on the business owner thinking, top line, what's my price? They've got this $30 million price in mind, mm-hmm. Okay? And that's not what's important. It's what he's going to put in his pocket after taxes.
Right.
They're also too focused on, there's two sides of the EBITDA coin. Yes, it's a good reference point for multiples at which a company sells for, but a lot of those multiples are for larger businesses over $100 million, not applicable to a company in a lower middle market where we focus between, you know, 20 and 100 million.
Right.
So that's, but that said, focusing on EBITDA, and EBITDA is your net profit number, your earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, amortization. It's your net profit number. That is a very important number, and that shows the profitability of the business. So focus on boosting EBITDA. You can do that by focusing on the business's core competencies, their most profitable income streams. You don't want us to focus on the collateral aspects of the business. You're getting ready to sell. Focus on what's more important. Having good, accurate, up-to-date financial information is crucial. You're definitely not ready if your tax returns are not done. You can also do things like strengthen your management team and your operational systems. That makes the integrity and the financial structure of your business sound. Shore up those contracts with your key customers.
Yep.
Extend the life of those contracts.
Mm-hmm.
These are just some of the things that you can do to get ready and maximize the proceeds that you're going to get when it comes time.
And I see a lot of business owners who are flying blind to this stuff. So I'm glad you brought them up and we're singing off the same page here. Do the market conditions right now indicate that it's a good time to sell your business?
Yeah, that's a good question also. I do believe it is. We've got some macro and microeconomic factors that make it a good time to sell. First of all, you've got the aging boomers, and the supply of businesses will be increasing. A lot of people that have been, you know, during the recession, it was the wrong time to sell. Valuations were down. Too much distressed activity. But now, post-recessions, and with the boomers having, you've got a number of factors there. Over in the next 5 years, 40% of family-owned businesses in the United States will be sold due to baby boomer retirements.
Wow.
You've got... every day for the next 15 years, another 10,000 baby boomers turn 65. You've got an increased pressure to invest. There's a lot of money, so-called dry powder, that private equity firms have that's available, and they've been able to borrow at lower interest rates. What happens if interest rates rise? Then there's going to be some less money available for those transactions.
That's why they raise the interest rates.
You've got things coming in now with Trump.
Right.
What's going to happen with capital gains? They're going to go up or down. Uncertainty means maybe it's the time to act.
Yeah.
Those are kind of some bigger pictures on the individual front. Comes down to the life cycle of the company. You want to sell when things are going well. The business is profitable. The business is growing. You haven't plateaued. You haven't reached the burnout point. The fact that you might be want to retire for age or personal reasons, family reasons, it's going to be the right time to sell
Right.
So a lot of these other things, money won't make a difference if it's just not the right time in your life. So a lot of stars have to line up for someone to be very motivated to go to market to sell their business.
Yeah, I think I'm glad you brought up that piece too, because it's not always just about the dollar. And you know, the timing and the conditions can be a big factor, especially as you said, as interest rates are climbing. You know, one of the reasons the government does that is to make it difficult sometimes to get that funding and curb the inflation that's going on. One last quick question. Auction processes for businesses can be a lucrative way to seek out either investments in your company or buyers. And a lot of business owners aren't even aware this exists. So can you describe what an auction process is and how does that help the business owner either find funding or sell?
Yeah, that's the benefit of, you know, using an investment banking firm like us, because we are aimed at creating an auction process. Now, the benefit of an auction process is that there's competition. You know, you may know, an owner may know, and probably does, three or four of his other strategic kind of competitors. They might be good acquirers for his business. They're not, you know, when there's more potential buyers, there's competition. The seller's got other offers to consider, and the price goes up. The value of a company is what a buyer's willing to pay based on their perceived value. It's been proven over and over. A single buyer values a company based on the value they see. You got strategic buyers in the industry. They see the company as a perfect fit. 1 + 1 = 3. A financial buyer, a private equity group, for example, they want to buy EBITDA. They just look at it as ROI. Is this company making business?
Right.
Different perceived value is what is value is all about. The auction process creates time pressure. We're going to invite both strategic and financial buyers. We'll create a deadline and say indications of interest are due by this date.
Mm-hmm.
Then we're going to then the number of qualified buyers that we spend time talking to going to be reduced after that, and then we'll set another deadline by which a letter of intent is due. A lot of gamesmanship in negotiations there. Always wait for the other guy to make a move first. Setting these deadlines creates also a fear that the company, which somebody might want to buy, could be lost.
Right.
They can't just sit there. They knew about this company. They've been watching it. They'd like to buy them. Well, now's the time.
Mm-hmm.
We invite them to the auction, and there's a deadline for them to step up, or somebody's going to outbid them.
This is absolutely a must-have if you're in a business and thinking about exit even within the next 10 years, because this is a process. Someone like Brian and his firm are the types of individuals that you need on your team to get this, to get the right price, to get the right other terms that you want in terms of transitioning all that sweat equity that you've put into your business. How do our listeners get a hold of you, Brian? What's the best way?
Well, you gave them our website there, bfaw.com. My bio is under the Los Angeles Orange County office. Can I get my phone number here? Is that all right?
Sure, yes. Absolutely.
You can call my office at 949-690-4100. They're welcome to call there, and happy to meet with them. My office, I love going out to the businesses where, you know, to see what's going on, walk the factory, meet the owners, meet the management team, get to know them, and put our team together. We want to match the right bankers at our firm for the type of business. We'll put together a team. What I get involved in is we're ready to put that, you know, blind executive summary together, what we call a confidential information memorandum that only goes out to companies after they sign a non-disclosure agreement. And I work well with the company's other accountants and lawyers.
Well, Brian, you've shared a lot of great information with our audience today. I appreciate that very much. Again, Brian Ballo, www.cfaw.com. Thank you so much for your time this morning. I hope you enjoy the rest of your weekend, okay?
Thank you, Daniel. I hope this was helpful to the listeners.
Absolutely. We're going to take a quick break, hear from our sponsors. When we get back, we've got our Give More to Get More segment. You are listening to the Financial Wake Up Show with Daniel Choi, KCAA 1050 AM and 106.5 FM. And welcome back. As you know, on every episode, to end the show, I'm going to highlight a nonprofit. And why is that? Because I don't think you can get more in life without giving more. So today, on this week's Give More to Get More segment, I want to welcome Jessica Starr, who is the founder of Muse Effect. And to give you some background on her, she's had the pleasure of working on Elton John's Vegas show, The Red Piano, H&M, and JCPenney's commercials, as well as several MTV, VH1, and Lionsgate productions. She's got a strong heart for social issues and is passionate about involving Muse Effect in projects that elevate social consciousness amongst the masses. The Industry Dance Awards awarded Muse Effect with the Artistic Dance Company Grant of 2015, applauding them for their impactful and thought-provoking work. Most recently, Muse Effect's PSAs were 953,000, inspiring action against cyberbullying, No Haters and Look at Me, Celebrating the Authentic You, which have brought a lot of publicity to the company's mission with over 1.5 million views on YouTube and press such as the Huffington Post, SF Global, and Dance Spirit Magazine. Muse Effect is quickly becoming well known for their unique integration. She's got over 18 years of industry experience using the dance company, and I'm here to talk about her organization. Really, the mission is to motivate young visionaries through her radiant spirit, positive energy, and empowering perspectives. Jessica, good morning, and welcome to the Financial Wake-Up Show. How are you today?
I'm so great. Thank you so much for having me on. It truly is an honor to be on your show. Thank you.
Absolutely. Now, let's start with a big picture question. What's the overall mission of Muse Effect?
Absolutely. Our work has done a really amazing job at igniting a lot of conversations that people need to have today. When you look at some of the biggest problems we're having socially, especially amongst the younger generation, it's simply because people aren't talking about things. You know, we're so busy being on our phones, texting, on our apps, too busy and too sort of what's happening here instead of having face-to-face conversations with people. So what our work is doing is really igniting and sparking some conversations that people need to be having, whether it's peer-to-peer, in the classroom, in the home. And the work that we've done thus far in our only 3 years of being a nonprofit has been mind-blowing and really shows me that we need to continue this particular unique vehicle of raising social awareness because it really is making a difference, impacting people on a much higher scale.
That's fantastic. Now, I noticed some of your project has included cyberbullying, No Haters and Look at Me, Celebrating the Authentic You. With social media, especially with our younger generation, these are topics we hear about all the time. So tell me a little bit about the genesis of these ideas. How did you come up with these types of awareness projects you're doing through the Muse Effect company?
The globe essentially for the last 13, 14 years, you know, teaching workshops and master classes in the area of dance. So we're extremely involved in the dance community. And time again, you know, we're hearing about, how, some of these babies so young, taking their own lives. Why? Because they were bullied, on the internet, on Facebook, on Instagram, on Twitter. And, for me, I'm like, how is that possible? How can someone find their life less worthy because, of someone they're not even having a relationship with, someone that's hiding behind a screen and posting mean and cruel things, and it's happening so much. So, what I came to realize is, we have this younger generation that's really placing all their self-worth and their self-value in what's happening on social media. And then the flip side is that we have a group of parents, teachers, mentors who live and live in that generation. So the disconnect of the generations was really causing a problem. So we created our first cyberbullying PSA called 953 Inspiring Action Against Cyberbullying. And essentially what this did is brought the topic of cyberbullying down to an even level where everyone understood how hard it is to live in today's society and have so much value placed on what other people are saying to you online. So this PSA I created off of a true story of a young girl, a
some dancer that I actually know personally who shared her story of all the things she had to endure through social media and all of the criticism about, I mean, everything from how she does her hair to how she moves to what she wears. And so using her story as a basis, we created this PSA simply because we felt it was something that we were called to do. The after effects were astounding because so many people related to this. So we're really, really proud that this one PSA is being shown across the globe in thousands and thousands of educational systems all over the place. And they're using it as a platform to start the discussion about cyberbullying. What is it? Who does it? Are you a victim? Are you a bully? And it's really helping the teachers and the parents to start this conversation with the younger generation. And silence really is the killer. When you don't talk about it, that's when you're in trouble. As soon as you start talking about bullying, you start talking about suicide, you start talking about social media, it sort of takes the sting out of it and allows people to realize that they're not alone. They're not the only ones experiencing it.
That's amazing work there. And just reading some stories about how this can affect the youth, I know that suicide rates are often published now about how kids are really, really affected by some of the things that are happening in our in this new world where, like you said, hiding behind a keyboard, people can just say whatever they want. You know, what are some of the areas that you provide support and what do you do to, you know, continue these types of projects and create awareness around these topics?
Absolutely. Well, we really have two vehicles of doing that right now. One is our PSAs, our public service announcements that we are creating on YouTube. So just like 953K, we released another one last year, Pulse, which is surrounding the violence, random acts of violence in this country, as well as No Haters. We've created a lot of other PSAs that are basically online. You know, we create these PSAs based off of donations and sponsorships that we're receiving from our supporters to develop PSAs, dance-driven, you know, purposeful films that surround some of the issues that are affecting our society the most. So our PSAs is one way. It's great because it doesn't matter what city you live in, what your household income is. You know, you can watch it on your iPhone or you can go to the public library and watch our PSAs. So we love that our work is not limited to your financial background or, you know, where you live. You can watch them anywhere. So that's one aspect of one vehicle. The other is we recently started our tour called the Divine Direction Tour. It's a stage show that we bring to cities. And basically what we're doing is we're taking some of the work you can see online and taking it to the stage. Because if I'm going to be honest with you, there's nothing like live art. There's nothing like watching dancers on the, you know, stage and hearing them breathe and seeing the sweat come off their face and feeling their dedication and their commitment to their movement. So we're taking the Divine Direction and we're bringing that into schools. We're having schools field trip to us and we're creating an educational outreach element where we do a 30 to 40 minute version of our stage show. And then I get out into the audience with the microphone and I start talking to these, you know, these young people about what are you affected by and what really moved you. And I sort of flip it on them and I say, what have you gone through that you couldn't potentially use your emotions, your feelings, and your experiences not to harbor and keep to yourself and, you know, feel bad or feel sad, but to empower other people and to educate other people. So, you know, I get these kids up on the stage and I can tell you the magic that happens. I mean, things that these kids have never been brave enough to talk about or admit, things they've gone through in their life. And then what I do is I challenge their peers to say how many people have also experienced these feelings. And it's amazing because all of a sudden it hands go all over the room and a community is developed that wasn't necessarily there before. And I encourage these young kids to say, okay, you've been through this. What can you do to educate and empower you know, other people that are also going through the same thing? So essentially people aren't out there feeling alone, you know, feeling like they're the only ones that are feeling depressed or just suicidal or, you know, lonely. I mean, these are feelings that really resonate through the youth these days, and that they keep it quiet. regional outreaches have been phenomenal and amazing and such great vehicles to connect with people and to empower them to really rise above some of the social issues that they're experiencing on their day-to-day life.
Wow. I mean, just the passion you're speaking with and the stories you're sharing, I can definitely see there's an impact that's being made, and I think that's remarkable. Now, how does your organization, MuseEffect, need help? How do our listeners get involved? Donations, volunteerism, what do you need?
Absolutely. We went on our third year, as a 501c3, and I'm really, really so proud to say that we've made so much headway. I've done so much in the first 3 years, but I'll be completely honest with you and let you know that we cannot continue this work that our world needs so much right now alone. A lot of the finances have come from myself and have been donated by our volunteers. But, you know, it's about, you know, we see the power of our vehicle. So now it's about expanding our reach and connecting with those who need it most. You know, anybody that's interested in donating and supporting our vision, we are looking for finances to continue our tour. This fall, we're going to be going to Ohio, Georgia, Alabama, Texas, Utah, New Mexico, Idaho. But every single one of those tours needs funding because, you know, everything from flying my cast of dancers to bringing our lights and costuming the dances and finding rehearsal space, all of these things, small and big, you know, take finances to make happen. So, you know, we have seen the product and we have seen the results that our work can have on people. So it's now it's about really cultivating a community of support in our donors to help us for everything from our stage shows and then also just the day-to-day administration fees, you know, keeping everything going, because sometimes the most work that's done is behind the scenes, and I'm sure most of you guys know. So it's the day-to-day, you know, emailing and phone calling and finding the right connections and the right schools to go to. All of that, we have a really wonderful admin and technical team behind us that I would love to be able to financially support instead of taking, you know, their donations all the time. So we definitely, our vision is big. We are very passionate about our work, so we absolutely need to start cultivating a strong community of supporters behind us in order to keep doing the work that's affecting our community.
Well, you heard it. They need support. It sounds like a fantastic tour coming up all across the United States. Powerful messaging. Do you have any events or fundraisers coming up that you want to promote?
We actually are looking to bring a show to Orange County this fall. So We're really excited about that. Dates are still tentative as we're looking to connect with a theater in Orange County or even Los Angeles for that matter that's willing to donate their space and be a part of bringing this mission, you know, to everyone that needs to hear it the most. So we're really excited about bringing a show to potentially Orange County this fall. So as soon as we get those dates, I'll reconnect with you and let you know so we can let your viewers know about it. But again, it's a matter of finding the funding and being able to put that on. So we have that. Also, October is always a big month for us. October is Cyberbullying Awareness Month. It's also Mental Health Month. And those are two big topics that we're really passionate about. So we'll be doing some different fundraisers, anything, you know, small from, you know, buying bracelets or t-shirts that support the cause. And that, again, allows us to create more PSAs and more work that, you know, is really affecting people.
Fantastic. Jessica, before I let you go, what's your website? How do people check you out?
Absolutely. It's MuseEffect.org. So MuseEffect, MuseEffect.org. That's our website. And we're also all over social media. Basically, if you look up MuseEffect on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, you can keep up to date on all things news and keep seeing all the work that we're doing to really inspire and empower generations.
Fantastic. And as everyone knows, their organization is going right on the website under our Give More to Get More tab, and we'll tag all their social media as well. Jessica, thank you so much for spending some time with us this morning, creating some awareness around your cause. We really enjoyed it. Enjoy the rest of your weekend, okay?
Yeah, thank you so much for your time.
Okay. So we're at the end of another episode, and again, some great information, great guests on the show today. If you have any doubt, just reach out. And I say that a lot, but I encourage you, call me, talk to me, ask questions. Phone number to reach me off the air, 8507-WAKE-UP. You can email me, daniel@financialwakeupshow.com. Till next week, I wish you health, wealth, and prosperity. You have been listening to the Financial Wake Up Show on KCAA, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and 102.3 FM. Have a fantastic weekend.